So if you're even able to keep track at this point, the president's legal battle with Stormy Daniels has taken a new turn, or maybe it's actually something of a U-turn this morning. Daniels' attorney is once again asking to be able to depose President Trump and his personal lawyer, Michael Cohen. Does this bring the president any closer to a courtroom when it comes to the non-disclosure agreement, the $130,000 paid to Daniels just before the 2016 election? Here with me right now, CNN legal analyst Paul Callant. So, Paul, Daniels' attorney has tried before to ask the judge, let me depose Trump and Cohen. And, I mean, in my layman's terms, the judge essentially said, slow down, like it's not the time. How is this going to be different now?
I don't think it is going to be different. The judge not only said it's not time now, he said, I want to remind the parties that I have some really important cases on my docket, and this is not one of them. That's in essence what he said. And the reason he said that was because essentially when you just back off and look at what this suit is about, it's about a woman being paid $130,000 to keep quiet about something. Okay, that's it. The federal judge has on his calendar people who have lost their lives in serious accidents, their businesses have been destroyed, there are suits sometimes between major corporations, and then you have this case. So why should this case jump to the front of the line, which in essence is what Mr. Avenatti is requesting? I don't see that that's going to happen because a second motion to depose the president is made.
Do you think this gets the president any closer at all to facing a deposition?
I think it's unlikely that he's going to ever be deposed in this case. And the reason I say that is because he did not sign the contract. Remember, when the case was first started, that was the big deal, that the president didn't sign it.
So it's not valid.
Well, if he didn't sign it, why do you have to take a deposition to prove that he didn't sign it? His signature's not on it. So they can already prove that. And I think the court will ultimately say, you don't need the president's deposition to prove that he didn't sign the contract.
Also, we've now learned that Daniels' attorney says that they have now worked with the sketch artist to try and find, and folks will remember this from the 60 Minutes interview with Anderson, to try and find the guy who Daniels says threatened her and threatened her family to keep quiet back in 2011 is when that happened. He spoke this morning about it. Let's listen to this.
A composite sketch has been produced. We're going to be reducing, or we're going to be releasing that tomorrow, along with a significant reward. Asking that the public come forward. We are very close to identifying this individual.
You are?
We are.
He says he's going to release it tomorrow. Do you see anything coming of this?
Well, I don't know. It depends on who it looks like, I guess. If it turned out that it looked like Keith Schiller, who used to be Trump's, you know, major bodyguard, that would be big, you know, or if it turns out to be somebody that we all know, that would be huge. But if it's just some vague photo.
But is it, I mean, I have no idea. I've never worked with a sketch artist or been involved in anything like it. Is it typical for someone to work with a sketch artist so many years later?
No, this is 7 years later we're doing a sketch. No, usually the sketch artist meets with the victim shortly after the crime while she still would have a clear recollection of what the person looked like. 7 years ago, who can remember what somebody looked like in a parking lot 7 years ago? She might be giving a sketch of the guy who took her ticket in the parking lot.
This artist is Lois Gibson. She's the sketch artist working with Stormy Daniels. Talk us through, you know, how she'll sit with her and try to trigger her memory then to that moment in the parking lot from 7 years ago.
Yeah, I can't talk for Lois. I can tell you how I would do it.
Sure.
Yeah, I would sit with the victim and would be in a relaxed atmosphere, and I would have my catalogs out, and I would make sure she's really relaxed, and we would start talking, and slowly when she would get comfortable, she would explain certain things to me about then. I would ask her about the weather, what she was wearing, just bring her back to that time, because it's traumatic and it was like a threat, it's in her head. So we just got to get back in there, and then she would explain, you know, the face, the features, if the person was angry, the race, you just go through a whole bunch of stuff, and slowly I would get the drawing down on paper, and then I would let her see it when I was probably 70-80% done, and I could see the expression on her face, how close I would be to the suspect.
Okay, so she may get there and it may be exactly who she believes it was, or Yes. You remember the story about the sketch in the Unabomber case. A lot of people may not realize this, right? But although this sketch was effective, it's now emerged that the witness may have actually been staring at the sketch artist so long that she described him. The sketch is actually more of the sketch artist than Ted Kaczynski. And so how often does this sort of memory contamination happen?
I think when you have a very good, when you have a good forensic artist, Lois Gibson is very good, very experienced. I don't think that happens much, but I have a lot of faith that Lois would have done a really good job on the sketch.
Diana Trepkov, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Brooke.
Thank you.
Take a look at these live pictures. Looks like Stormy Daniels is arriving at the federal courthouse in New York City right now. We got a bunch of cameras over there. You see all the photographers chasing her as she's trying to make her way. I assume she has good security there. Oh, there she is in the pink. Looks like it's pink. Walking in there. She's got security as she's being escorted into the federal courthouse. What a scene this is going to be. We're going to stay on top of that. It's a moment. Joseph Marino is still with us. Joseph is a former Department of Justice prosecutor. You've dealt with a lot of these kinds of cases, not these kinds of cases. It's pretty extraordinary what's going on in New York right now.
Thankfully, not these kinds of cases, yeah. Wolf. I mean, Mr. Avenatti, Ms. Daniels' lawyer, is exceptional at keeping the story in the media. I mean, it's really unprecedented. So he's battling not in the court of law, but in the court of public opinion. Now, I'm not sure how much value Ms. Daniels is adding at this hearing, but she certainly, you know, keeps our interest, and it's a reminder that you never know where a case like this is going to go. It made big headlines months ago when we heard about this payment. It could actually wind up being significantly more legal jeopardy than even the special counsel.
Yeah, we're going to watch it every step of the way, guys. Thank you very much.
Stormy Daniels. She has nothing to do necessarily with what's being decided today. It is spectacle.
It is.
The notion that the judge maybe will let her address the court, you're saying no.
Well, I'd be shocked if the judge did allow this because she has an attorney present who is her representative to address the court.
No.
So what would she be addressing the court
about?
Why is
she there, Paul Callen?
Well, I take a look at the cameras on screen right now, and I think that would answer the question. It's a great publicity opportunity, and who knows? If she gets to speak in court, it'll be an even bigger opportunity. Now, I suppose the judge could say, well, can you confirm that Mr. Avenatti is your attorney and is authorized to represent
speak for you?
I mean, who knows?
That would be about it. That would be about the only relevant thing that she could offer legally.
Does your client, the Stormy Daniels, does she have a message for the president and perhaps for the first lady?
Not at this point in time, no.
Should Michael Cohen be representing himself?
There's an old saying that any attorney that represents himself has a fool for a client. I think that would certainly be true in this instance, no doubt.
Does Michael Cohen have anything to be afraid of if he has recordings, if the judge has recordings of him and you or your client or something to do with your case?
Well, I don't know that the judge would have any such recordings, but if Michael Cohen was making any recordings of anyone without their permission, I think that could pose a serious, serious problem for Michael Cohen.
Was Ms. Daniels on the phone with him in California?
Materials that were seized first?
I'm sorry?
Are you going to weigh in on who should look at the seized materials first, the taint team, somebody appointed by the judge, or Mr. Cohen, Mr. Trump?
We may weigh in on that. We're going to see how things progress here today.
Why do you think the president is trying to...
The documents first? Yeah. I mean...
I don't think there's any question that this matter should be handled similar to any other matter, and that is the taint team should review the documents.
Okay. Just wanted to hear what Avenatti just said. Taint team reviewing the documents. That's what he wants. We know, of course, Team Cohen. Why is Stormy Daniels even in this courtroom, period? Is this just total spectacle?
It's so that CNN and all the other cable news networks will cover this breathlessly start to finish, because there's no other reason for her to be there other than Michael is a shrewd consumer of the culture and knows that if he just shows up as handsome as he is, there's not going to be the crush of media. She shows up and that doubles down on the media.